Welcome, I'm Catherine Hadro, and this is EWTN Pro-Life Weekly.
Conscience rights violation. A former official at the Department of Health and Human Services reacts to the DOJ's dismissal of a conscience rights lawsuit against a Vermont hospital. What he is saying about the influence of President Biden and current HHS Secretary Javier Becerra. State rights. We speak one-on-one with the former governor of Wisconsin, Scott Walker, about the important role governors and states play in advancing life and what the pro-life issue means to him personally.
Even if your entire family isn't supporting you, even if all your friends aren't supporting you, there's always places like Mary Shelter.
Open arms. We introduce you to a Virginia maternity home that honors our Blessed Virgin by helping expecting mothers in need. Hear the stories of three strong moms and how Mary Shelter helped protect them and their baby.
A former Health and Human Services official says President Joe Biden and HHS Secretary Javier Becerra have betrayed medical professionals being forced to assist in abortions. This comes after the Department of Justice recently dropped a case involving a Catholic nurse claiming she was forced to participate in an abortion against her will at a Vermont hospital. Roger Severino, former director of the Office at Civil Rights at HHS, says his office ordered an investigation when the Catholic nurse from the University of Vermont Medical Center filed her complaint during the previous administration. That investigation found violations against the hospital, which led to the lawsuit by the DOJ, only for it to be dropped 2 weeks ago by the Biden administration's Department of Justice. Severino responded by writing for the National Review, quote, "Big abortion is desperate to eliminate conscience protections for medical professionals that have been in place for decades because it helps their bottom line to have more people complicit in their sordid business. And now with President Biden and HHS Secretary Javier Becerra in power, the abortion industry is getting its wish." Severino has been an outspoken critic of HHS Secretary Becerra and his pro-abortion record. In May, Becerra failed to acknowledge an existing federal ban on partial birth abortion during a Capitol Hill hearing. During Becerra's time as a California congressman, he voted twice in 2013 and 2015 in favor of late-term abortions. He also has a history of voting against the Hyde Amendment, which prevents the taxpayer funding of abortion. And joining us now on Skype is Roger Severino himself, the former director of the Office of Civil Rights at the Department of Health and Human Services, who today is the director of the HHS Accountability Project at the Ethics and Public Policy Center. Welcome back to the show, Roger. You ordered an investigation when this Catholic nurse filed a complaint with HHS. What's your reaction that the Biden administration's DOJ has dropped this lawsuit without giving any reason? And what, in your opinion, could have led to that decision?
Well, so many emotions. Outrage is first, and sorrow. There are real people hurt by this. This is as open and shut a conscience violation you will ever find. The nurse informed her bosses that she could not in good conscience assist in an abortion. Then they tricked her into showing up for the abortion procedure. They said, "Don't hate me," when she walked in because they knew she objected, and they forced her to do it anyway on pain of losing her job and possibly her license. Those are the facts. The University of Vermont Medical Center is unrepentant, and they are unwilling to change their policies to come into compliance with the law. We had career professionals at the Conscience and Religious Freedom Division at HHS that investigated this over a couple years and reached the conclusion that the law was broken and we could not continue to fund them. So we referred it to the DOJ, who filed suit. I cannot underscore how rare it is for DOJ to simply drop a case after it's been signed off by career people at HHS, career people at DOJ, and getting literally nothing in return. It is an outrage.
So the fact that DOJ did drop this case, how much of an influence do you think President Biden and or Secretary Becerra had in its dismissal?
Well, given that this was such a high-profile case, I find it very hard to believe that Becerra was not involved. We, when we were at HHS under Trump, elevated it all the way to the secretary and beyond to the White House because it was such an important issue. Again, These laws were passed by Congress on a bipartisan majority consensus in the wake of Roe v. Wade to not force people to assist in abortions. This is a popular position with the American people. And for Biden and Becerra to turn their back on the law and to throw these nurses and medical professionals under the bus in the name of abortion ideology, it's just insulting to so many medical professionals who are there on the front lines, especially during COVID, to help save lives, not to help end them.
Mm-hmm. Becerra has been confirmed as HHS Secretary for about 5 months now. What have you made as his term so far? What's on your radar that you want our viewers to know?
Well, he's all about abortion first and COVID second. Look what he's doing now with the Vermont case, with the Hyde Amendment, with Title 10 funding of abortion clinics. He is laser focused on the abortion agenda instead of COVID, and it shows. So on the conscience issues, he's still going forward on trying to tear down everything that was done under Trump that is, again, popular with American people. My eye is focused on the conscience and religious freedom division itself, which is designed to vindicate the rights of nurses and medical professionals and patients when their rights are violated against the law. That division is crucial to making sure that our rights are actually enforced. And we'll see if Becerra has the spine to stand up to the abortion extremists that are pushing him and Biden to shut it down, because it would be an incredible shame if he actually would do that, and he would have to be held accountable by Congress.
And I think what's all the more disappointing is that Becerra is a baptized Catholic. I know you're Catholic as well, Roger. We're going to have to leave it at that. But Roger Severino, Senior Fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
And joining us now on Skype is Prudence Robertson, Communications Associate for the Susan B. Anthony List. First, Prudence, my question to you is, what is the Susan B. Anthony List's reaction that the Biden administration's DOJ has dismissed this Catholic nurse's lawsuit who says she was forced to participate in an abortion?
Well, Catherine, unfortunately, it's no surprise. Joe Biden is the most pro-abortion president that our nation has ever seen. And despite his claims of being Catholic and Javier Becerra's claims of being Catholic, as you said before, they seem to have absolutely no interest or respect in the deeply held morals and beliefs of Catholics like you and I and these healthcare professionals. And this isn't the first time this has happened. I'm sure you remember the case of Kathy DiCarlo, who was also forced to either participate in an abortion or lose her job. So we know that this is purely political, and we're so thankful to Mr. Severino for the work that he did in the Office of Civil Rights during the Trump administration to strengthen conscience protections. They are so important.
Absolutely. I think that's so important for us to continue to speak about, because conscience rights do have an important role in the pro-life movement. Prudence, while I have you, I want to turn subjects a little bit. There was a major pro-life votes in the Senate late on Tuesday. Fill us in on this voterama.
Absolutely, yes. So late into the night last night, senators went through a budget resolution process that included a voterama, a long series of votes on multiple issues. And we were very fortunate to see three pro-life votes happen last night, one on the Hyde Amendment, one on the Pain-Capable Unborn Child Protection Act, and one on the Protecting Individuals with Down Syndrome Act. And the results of these votes is that we got to see there is strong unity from GOP, Republicans, senators, in support of all of these measures. And Senator Joe Manchin, a Democrat, actually bucked the extremism of his party, crossed party lines to vote yes on all three of these measures. We are so excited and thankful to see his courageousness on these votes. And it's also notable that Senators Warnock and Kelly, representing Georgia and Arizona respectively, they voted no on all of these common sense measures, despite the fact that their very own constituents support measures limiting abortion and keeping taxpayers away from the abortion industry. We know that they're going to suffer politically at the ballot box for these votes later on, and SBA List is already in the field in Georgia and Arizona, making sure that voters understand just how extreme their views are on abortion.
Really significant, and I know a lot of pro-lifers are holding out hope that Senator Manchin will stay strong on this pro-life issue. Prudence Robertson with the Susan B. Anthony List, thank you as always.
Thanks, Catherine.
This year has been a strong year for the pro-life movement at the state level. According to the Guttmacher Institute, a pro-abortion research group that tracks abortion-related laws, there have been nearly 600 pro-life bills introduced across 47 states this year so far. These state-level successes point to the important role pro-life governors play, which is why we wanted to discuss this with someone who knows that responsibility well, former Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker. Walker was the 45th governor of Wisconsin from 2011 to 2019. While governor, he signed legislation that stopped taxpayer dollars from paying for abortions for government workers. He also prevented abortion vendors from receiving Title X family planning funds, so funds went to life-affirming care instead. I spoke with the former governor a few days ago. Here's our interview. Joining us now on Skype is the former governor of Wisconsin, Scott Walker. He today is the president of the Young Americas Foundation. Governor, welcome to the show. I first want to ask you, what does the pro-life issue mean to you?
What's the core of everything we do? We talk frequently here, not just around the 4th of July, but at this conference and others like it at Young Americas Foundation, all about the Constitution and our founding principles. And when you think about the Declaration of Independence, what did we declare? We declared our independence, and we said that our freedoms that are ultimately something granted to us by God, not by the government, and they begin with life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So it's the fundamental right. If you don't get that right, everything else is secondary.
This year has been an unprecedented year for the pro-life movement at the state level. More than 500 pro-life bills introduced across 47 states so far. As a former governor, can you speak to the important role that governors do play in the pro-life movement?
Well, I think as much as we talk about the White House, it really the core of what we need to do in the pro-life movement is happening at the state level. Mm-hmm. It's governors and state lawmakers all across the country. It's why the work being done not only with students with Young Americas Foundation, but Students for Life and other groups like that is so critically important.
I have to ask this as well, Governor. Is there a pro-life accomplishment you are the most proud of?
Well, I signed a number of bills. Probably the best thing I did was get rid of funding long before they were talking about the national level. Excuse me, getting rid of funding for Planned Parenthood. In our case, we didn't just cut the funding. We actually sent it to non-controversial entities like public health departments that helped provide assistance for women and children and families. But we didn't have to do it through Planned Parenthood. So I think that was probably one of the most important things we did. Although one of the other bills I was proud to sign was a law we'd worked on for quite some time, and that is requiring an ultrasound before abortion was provided. Ideally, we'd love to not have any abortions, but as a starter, we knew that if people could see, as Tonette and I, my wife and I saw when we had our first baby picture, which was an ultrasound, we could see at that point our son Matthew turned on his side. His thumb was in his mouth. You could see that he was sucking his thumb even on that ultrasound. When people see images like that, and today ours was just a regular picture. My goodness, today when they're 3D, it is one of the most potent tools we have to change the hearts and minds of not just everyday people, but particularly of mothers who might be in this very difficult situation under extreme pressure, mm-hmm. oftentimes from family and friends and others, to end the life of their unborn baby.
What advice or encouragement would you give to governors today to advance the pro-life cause at the state level?
Oh, be strong. Mm-hmm. Be bold. Be strong. Don't back down. There's going to be incredible pressure out there. But I think the public's with us. When you see the horrific actions that people like Ralph Northam tried to defend in Virginia, where you had they're defending abortion on demand all the way through, even past the moment of being born, it's unbelievable. And I think the public is turning our way. I think this new Generation Z is the pro-life generation. I think there's incredible support. Probably the best advice is just to call it what it is. This is killing. This is murder.
You mentioned Gen Z. You're the president of Young Americas Foundation. I'm speaking to you from your national conference. You're on the board of Students for Life of America. What role, Governor, do you see the younger generation having in advancing the pro-life cause?
Well, I think this is the social justice movement of our time. I think students overall, not just in our movement, not just at our conferences, but overall in society, in high school and college, they're very concerned about justice. They're very concerned about fairness. And to me, we need to capture that energy and apply it to the pro-life movement. I think young people showing up, not only campaigning, but showing up at hearings, I think showing up at legislative events, letting their voices be heard is extremely powerful. because the mass media, a lot of the traditional media sources out there like to somehow think that young people do not favor the pro-life movement. Nothing could be further from the truth. If anything, young people today, Generation Z, are some of the quickest moving in our direction.
Thank you for your pro-life leadership, Governor Scott Walker, former governor of Wisconsin, and today the president of the Young Americas Foundation. God bless you.
Thank you. You too.
To watch our entire interview, including Scott Walker's answer on whether he plans to run for president again in 2024, head to EWTN's YouTube page. Coming up, the parents of a two-year-old encounter a huge disappointment after a European court fails to protect the life of their child. I speak out next.
But this place is a home. They treat you like family. They encourage you to be who you can be.
Plus, a maternity home in Virginia has opened its arms to hundreds of expecting mothers. Why past and present residents are saying it's not a shelter, it truly is a home. Next.
Nobody has a choice over life or death except God.
That's our EWTN foundress, Mother Angelica, speaking on the gift of life. She did that so boldly and frequently. August 15th will mark the 40-year anniversary of EWTN. And in celebration of the Global Catholic Network, EWTN is commemorating Mother's legacy with the first ever annual Mother Angelica Award. Find out who the first award recipient is with a special program, Witness to Providence, airing on Sunday, August 15th at 8 p.m. Eastern. Welcome back to EWTN Pro-Life Weekly. I'm Catherine Hadro. The European Court of Human Rights has rejected a parent's appeal to keep their two-year-old daughter on life-saving treatment. That is this week's Speak Out segment. Two-year-old Alta Fixsler was born prematurely in England in 2018 and initially showed no signs of life until she was resuscitated and placed on a ventilator. But she suffered serious brain and nerve damage. Royal Manchester Children's Hospital, where Alta is being cared for, told Alta's parents their daughter should be taken off life support and allowed to die. And the European Court of Human Rights has ruled in favor of the hospital, rejecting the parents' appeal. Alta's parents, who are Hasidic Jews, said they believe in the sanctity of life and want to fight for their two-year-old daughter's life. The case has drawn international scrutiny as Alta's parents are Israeli citizens and her father also holds U.S. citizenship. Hospitals in Israel and the U.S. have offered to treat the two-year-old, and U.S. senators like Senator Marco Rubio and Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer have tried to intervene in the case. Two-year-old Alta's case is being compared to the previous Charlie Gard case and the Alfie Evans case, another instance of a UK hospital holding a child against their parents' will to end their life-sustaining treatment, even when other hospitals are offering to care for the child. But the UK's National Health Service is refusing to discharge Alta. We need to wake up to the reality that cases like this are happening more and more frequently in the UK. This should concern everyone who believes in the right to life and religious liberty, and those who simply believe a parent is more invested in their child's life than a hospital system. Yes, two-year-old Alta's life looks different than most. This sweet child has suffered severe brain injury and requires a lot of medical attention. But her life, it's worth fighting for. Her precious life is worth medical resources. As this case continues to develop, please consider how you can speak out about Alta to bring awareness to this distressing situation. And most importantly, let us all pray. For this week's Pro-Life Focus, we take you to Mary's Shelter, a special maternity home that reminds us that when you're in need, it's best to turn into your mother's arms.
I think I was lucky because at the time there was only one room left.
Just over an hour outside our nation's capital in Fredericksburg, Virginia, sits Mary's Shelter. Giving shelter here means more than just housing. It means providing a home with the best mother of all.
We took the name Mary's Shelter at the time because we didn't mean it really in the word shelter, like shelter, we meant it as Mary's sheltering arms. So, you know, we just knew that the Blessed Mother was the ultimate mother who needed that room at the inn, and we just wanted to honor her.
Kathleen Wilson is executive director of Mary's Shelter. The Catholic wife and mother to 12 children founded it about 15 years ago.
Mary's Shelter mission is to provide housing, long-term transitional housing for women who are in a crisis during pregnancy. And I like to say that because generally the pregnancy is not the crisis. It's the gazillion other things going on in their lives.
What started off as a two-room apartment has grown into a community of shared homes today. More than 400 mothers have gone through Mary's Shelter program so far. That's more than 400 unique stories. And today we share with you three of those women's witnesses, including 19-year-old resident Michaela, who came to Mary's Shelter about 1 year ago.
Would you mind even kind of taking us back to that time, finding out you're gonna have a baby? What kind of emotions are running through your mind at that time, and what was that conversation like with your family?
At the time, only me and my boyfriend knew about it, and I was like, I don't know why, but I felt very excited. I told my mom next, and then she was extremely shocked. She said she started to have migraines after that moment. But she was very supportive of me. My dad was, he was in so much shock. I think he like ended up vomiting like just like that day after hearing it. And so I got kicked out because he couldn't stand to see me in that state.
Kicked out of her home, Michaela moved to four different houses before arriving to Mary's Shelter.
What have you been the most grateful for when it comes to what Mary's Shelter has offered?
I think I'm most grateful for how much they've taught me indirectly. While I was here, I think I learned how to like be courteous to people. Mm-hmm. I learned to take care of myself, like not cleaning just because they tell me to, but cleaning because it makes me feel better. And I think it's also taught me to be more independent, like that they're there for me. They're there if I fall, but they're not going to baby me, not like my parents. So
that baby Michaela was pregnant with is today her 3-month-old daughter, Amy.
How is it being a mom?
I love it. I really do love it. Like, I don't necessarily have a dream for, like, where I want to live or what I particularly want to end up as. It's more like I want, like, now my dreams are, like, I want her to explore everything.
And baby Amy's life is now celebrated in Michaela's family.
My dad absolutely loves Amy. Like, every time we come over, like, he's the one who comes to the car to pick her up. He wants to be the first one to hold her. And he loves to spoil her.
It doesn't even feel like a shelter. I absolutely don't like the word shelter, to be honest. Because when I come here, I was like, wait, this is a shelter?
This young mother, a Mary's Shelter resident who goes by the name Joy, does not have any family in the United States.
I am originally from West Africa, Freetown, Sierra Leone. So Sierra Leone is the country, Freetown is the city.
Joy came to Mary's Shelter about a year and a half ago when she was pregnant, could no longer afford rent, and was about to be homeless.
Tell us what it's like to live in Mary's Shelter.
It is absolutely beautiful because it changed my whole life. I had nowhere to go. Like I mentioned earlier, I had no family to be with. So me being homeless would have caused me a lot of trouble with my son. Mm-hmm. And at 8 months, since I had gestational diabetes and I was going through like health issues, if I didn't have this place, Mary's Shelter, I don't know what would have happened to me. But it's spacious. You have your kitchen, you have everything. You have your own bed. You don't absolutely have to bring nothing. I didn't bring a single thing here. I have bed, I have my cupboard, I have my room, which I love.
Thanks to the resources at Mary's Shelter, Joy is now on track to become a nurse. But nothing will beat her role as mom to 1-year-old son, Davian.
He is so sweet. He changed my life in so many ways. When I had him, he just changed me in so many ways. Now he's starting to talk and he points his finger at you like, stop it, stop it. Like, he's an incredible boy.
two that close together, boy, I was just shocked.
Rachel, a former resident, came to Mary's shelter with one baby in her arms and one in her womb as she took a courageous step to get here.
Rachel, it was about 6 years ago when you first came to Mary's shelter. Can you take us back to that specific time in your life and what you were going through?
I came to Mary's shelter when my daughter was about 5 months old, and I was newly pregnant, just found out with my son. So I was in a domestic violence situation. Didn't know that's what it was, but I did it for my daughter. I wanted her to grow up in a healthy, calm environment.
Mary's shelter is unique from most other maternity homes because pregnant women can bring any other children they have with them as well.
Right from day one, most of the calls that we got were from women that had another child. So originally, not knowing what we were doing, starting a ministry, you know, we just said, okay, well, we'll take one child if they're, you know, three and under. Well, then that call came for that child who was four. We just decided, because each one of these stories is so hard and heart-wrenching to hear in the beginning, we were like, we're not turning anybody away.
You're meeting each woman where she is at.
Where she is, yes, you know? Absolutely. And they are all so unique.
The support and resources at Mary's shelter not only helped save Rachel's life, it transformed it. Today, she's a registered nurse who no longer lives at Mary's shelter, but is forever grateful for this shelter that she calls a home.
I'm just amazed. It seems like you have accomplished so much in these past 6 to 7 years. You're now a registered nurse.
I am.
And you seem like such an example of what a strong mother is. Can you speak to where you're at today and how has Mary's shelter helped you get to this point?
They have encouraged me all the way. I am a Christian and I could not have done it without God, and God led me to Mary's shelter. I had the opportunity to be here, and then he lined up people to come in here, the partnerships that they have, and offer me education, and offer me mentorship, and offer me nutrition classes, and offer me just more and more opportunities and opportunities to just grow spiritually. Mary's shelter helped me relax a little bit and just see what isn't looking ahead. And I don't have to look behind anymore.
What strong women. Mary's shelter is totally free for all the moms, made possible by donations. You can learn more at maryshelterva.org. That does it for this edition of EWTN Pro-Life Weekly. Until next time, we'd love to hear from you. Find us on social media at EWTN Pro-Life on all social media platforms, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, we're there. You can also send us a message by emailing prolifeweekly@ewtn.com. We'd love to hear from you. Remember, life is a gift. Your life is a gift. God bless.